Hello class, welcome to the week 11 material, and in this week we're going to be introducing something called the command line interface. And this is going to involve taking a little bit of a break from Python. So in Python we've done some really nice mathematical calculations, user interaction, reading information from files and all that good stuff. We're going to take a little bit of a break from that and explore something called the command line interface. So in the case of Python, we're using commands to get the computer to perform some series of tasks or calculations, whatever it might be. A command line interface also involves typing out commands, but the commands that we type out are geared towards navigating a file system as opposed to running, say, some computations or something like that. And to sort of understand what exactly is going on here, I'm going to go ahead and contrast the command line interface to the graphical user interface, which a graphical user interface is what you're more accustomed to in everyday life, where you navigate a file system by pointing and clicking to pretty icons. And then that's how you basically just navigate a file system on a regular computer. Command line interface, you navigate a file system as well, but instead of pointing and clicking to stuff, you navigate a file system by typing out a series of commands and then running those commands to navigate the file system. Now, this might seem really antiquated. Like, why in the world are we doing this tedious process or seemingly tedious process when we have these really nice, pretty graphical user interfaces already available to us? And there's a couple reasons why command line interface is still relevant even to today's world. For one thing, graphical user interfaces consume a lot of memory and a lot of processing power, whereas command line interfaces don't. They're very cheap in terms of computational power and in terms of memory required to use them. And there are a couple of systems where this is very important. One is web servers. So web servers need to be run as efficiently as possible. So those use the command line interface to navigate the file system on a web server or on a web page. And the other one is a supercomputer. Think about supercomputers, though, as they don't have the conventional operating systems that Mac, like a desktop Mac or a PC might have. And currently, the only way to navigate most supercomputers is to use the command line interface in order to do something on the supercomputer. So that's why command line interface is something valuable to know about. But most of the time, probably what you're going to be using this for is working with some sort of program or file on a remote server, which is what you're going to get some practice with here as we log into a class server, which is a remote server, and do some files, do some stuff on there, and then which will also involve running some Python programs, but we'll get to that later on. But the main emphasis is going to be on the command line interface. Now, there's a bit of a setup that goes into using it on a Windows machine using MOBA Xterm. That's a relatively straightforward process, and you're going to skip a lot of the steps that I'm about to show when setting it up on the Mac, but there is a walkthrough on how to set that up that should be on the class website. Hopefully you all got that email about where to find that. So just follow the walkthrough, the installation process. Hopefully everything goes well. If not, then you have my email address. But here I'm going to show you how to actually set this up or get going with the command line interface on the Macintosh operating system. So first thing you want to do is you want to go to Finder. And then the next thing you want to go to after that is Applications. Scroll down to the bottom to find a folder called Utilities. Inside Utilities, there's a program in here called Terminal. And also, if Xquartz was installed correctly, you should see Xquartz in here as well. But the application you want to open is Terminal. So if you double-click that, it should open up a display that looks like this. Now, the font's a little bit larger than what's probably showing up on your screen when you do this. And that's just because I want to make sure that on the screen recording, this all is very clearly readable. So I have the font set to be something a little bit larger than what's probably showing up on your screen. And one thing that you can do to save yourself the trouble of going through and navigating this again, constantly going through the applications, utilities, and then terminal all over again, when this thing pops up in the dock, one thing you do is right-click on it, go to this option submenu, and then make sure that the option here, keep in dock, is checked. That way, when you go to open terminal again, you just simply go down here, pop it open, and then you should see something that looks like this. And the very first command that we're going to run is the command that will allow us to log onto the remote server. And each one of you has a student account set up. And here I'm going to show you more or less how exactly you'll go about logging onto that remote account on the remote server. And that's going to use the SSH command. So that's going to involve typing out SSH hyphen capital X, make sure the X is capitalized. It's very important that it is. Otherwise, things are not going to work properly when you get onto the server. So make sure that X is capitalized. And then your 4x4. So I'm typing my 4x4 in this case, but you're going to want to put your own 4x4 right here, not my 4x4. And then at symbol METR1313.net, make sure the .net is in there. And then to run a command that you typed out, you just simply hit the enter or return key. And when you do that, you'll probably see something like this pop up when you log onto the server for the very first time, a sort of a warning message saying, do you really want to log onto the server? Just go and hit yes, and you should only see this warning message once. And then after that, you should see something that looks like this. Here, I'll ask you to enter a password. On the newer Macintosh operating systems, you'll probably see a little key symbol pop up here. But I'm using an older version of the Macintosh operating system, so it doesn't have that. But if it looks different on your screen, that's probably the main difference that you'll see. And this is where things might get a little bit confusing and non-intuitive when you're working with the command line interface. So here, I'm going to type some keys into the password field or hit some keys. So I'm hitting some keys, but you can see nothing is actually showing up on the screen here. You might be wondering what's happening to all the keys that I'm typing. This is something that's kind of unique to the command line interface. When you go to enter a password or a secure text field, more generally as it's referred to, when you go to enter a password, when you go to hit the keys, the keystrokes won't actually show up on the screen. The computer is receiving the keystrokes, but they're not actually being displayed on the screen versus a more conventional password or secure text field. When you're typing stuff out, you'll see the little black dots show up in the field to sort of tell you how many characters you've typed in, and also as a way of acknowledging the keystrokes that you actually that you're actually typing. But in the command line interface, nothing actually shows up. So you just type out your password like you would normally, just keeping in mind that what you're typing is not going to show up on the screen in any way, shape, or fashion. So just keep that in mind when you're going to type in your password. It is receiving the keystrokes, but nothing's actually showing up. So once you get done typing the password, you'll hit enter again. And then if all goes well, you should see XQuartz pop up on the bottom right like it did on my screen. And then if everything goes well after that, you should see something that looks like this. So on the left-hand side of the screen, you should see a little M highlighted in blue, this little squiggly line, which is called a tilde, a set of brackets, a dollar sign. So if all that shows up, then you have successfully logged on to the server. If not, then you might have mistyped this command up here, or maybe you entered a password incorrectly. But if all goes well, you should see something that looks like this. And one thing that you can do to sort of confirm that everything was set up so that is XQuartz is correctly configured to make sure that you logged into the server correctly, one thing that you can do is to open a set of graphical displays. And one such graphical display is going to involve the xclock command. So if you type out xclock, all one word, and then hit enter, should open a nice graphical display that looks like a clock, just showing the time, which is probably not your local time. I think that's actually Eastern time. But as long as the display opens, then that all works well. Now, in Windows, this gets kind of weird because for some reason, when you open the graphical display from MOBA Xterm, that a display will open, but it will open behind the MOBA Xterm window. So one thing that you can do to check to make sure the display actually opens is go down to the bottom bar on the Windows computer and check to see if there's a new window that opened next to the MOBA Xterm, or if you don't see it there, then you can minimize MOBA Xterm and see if the display opened anywhere at all. But that's just a weird Windows thing that unfortunately I have no control over. So if it doesn't look like the graphical display opens on a Windows machine, it might have actually opened. It's just hidden behind the MOBA Xterm window. So just make sure you check for that. And then another thing that you'll sometimes see when you open these graphical displays on the server is you'll see these weird messages that pop up. You don't really need to pay attention to these unless the display itself doesn't actually open. So if you see a message that says warning cannot open display or something like that, then something did go wrong, in which case check to make sure you actually logged in with a capital X up here and make sure that XQuartz was installed. If you're getting that message after installing XQuartz, make sure you restart your computer. So if you don't restart your computer after installing XQuartz, then you'll get that error message saying cannot open display. So make sure you restart your computer before attempting to log onto the server. And then another display that we can open to sort of confirm the graphical displays are opening is this one called X eyes, again, all one word. And if you type that out and hit enter, it opens a fun little program that has a pair of eyes, and the eyes follow your cursor all over the screen. And if we want to make this really fun, and I'll go ahead and make this full screen. There we go. That's something that might freak people out if they happen to walk by your screen while this is open. They say, what in the world's going on there? But they're just a couple of eyes whose pupils just follow the mouse all over the screen. So that's a fun little thing to play around with. But as long as this opens, the key thing is, as long as this opens, then things should be set up correctly. And the last thing that I want to go ahead and introduce in this segment is how to get off the server. So once you're logged onto the server, you might be wondering, how exactly do I get off the server? And that's going to involve the logout command. So simply type out logout, then hit enter. And then sometimes when you type logout on a Mac, the screen will kind of hang, in which case you want to make sure you quit Xcourts. And then after quitting Xcourts, then that should complete the logout process. And the way you'll know the logout process is complete is if you see this message saying connection to METR1313.net closed. If you see that, then you're no longer logged in the server and you successfully logged out of the server. If you don't see that, make sure you quit Xcourts. And then after that, you should see this message pop up. And then you should have been able to log off of the server then. So that's going to do it for this segment. So this is just basic logging in, command line interface introduction. Next segment, we'll talk about how to actually work with file systems, and that will also entail getting into some Python stuff.